سفرهای مقامهای امارات اسلامی در این روزها و دیدارهای پشت دربهای بسته با خارجی ها به چه هدف است؟ آیا تا اکنون این نشست ها سودی به مهار اوضاع بشری در افغانستان داشته است؟ تا چه زمان و چرا باید افغانستان متکی به کمک های خارجی باشد؟ پول های کمک شده پس از فروپاشی نظام به افغانستان در کجاند و چگونه هزینه می شوند؟ و در نهایت آخرین گزینه برای حل مشکلات در کشور در چیست؟ سلام، وقتتان بخیر. من حامد بهرام هستم. شما را به یک دیگر از برنامه های ویژه ما خوش آمدید می گویم. آلن دلتروز، رئیس نهاد صدای جنیوا با ما روی خط اسکایپ اند و با ایشان روی این موارد به بحث خواهیم پرداخت. مستر آلن دلترو، the director general of Geneva Call, it's an honor to have you with us today.
Good morning, sir. It's an honor for me to be with you.
Thank you so much. Let's start from here. You had a 4-day session with the delegation of the Islamic Emirate of Afghanistan in Geneva. Much of the information had not been leaked out. Would you please brief us more about the meeting that you had with them?
Yes, with much pleasure. First, thank you for having me on your channel. Just for me to start, maybe let me just give you a few words of what Geneva Call is. We are an international humanitarian organization that works in conflict areas. Can you hear me properly?
Yes, I do hear you.
Okay. And our aim is to enhance compliance with international humanitarian law by engaging armed actors on a wide range of humanitarian norms. Our ultimate goal, if you want, is to strengthen the protection of civilians by raising awareness on humanitarian imperatives among both armed non-state actors and community leaders. So we are working around the globe, and the meeting that we had last week with the delegation from the Islamic Emirate of Afghanistan here in Geneva is not something extraordinary for us. We do invite regularly to Geneva, that is to a neutral country, Switzerland being a neutral country, representatives of armed movements or non-recognized governments to discuss strictly humanitarian issues with them. This is what we've done last week with the delegation from the Islamic Emirate of Afghanistan.
Are you happy with the meeting that you had with them? Do you think that there were some satisfactory outcomes of those meetings that you had with them?
I was happy on two issues. First of all, the depth of the conversation we had. They were here for 3 days strictly with us, with Geneva Call. And then for 2 days, we used our platform, Geneva Call's platform, to allow other organizations that wanted to meet with them to have the chance to sit down and talk with them. So I was not in the other meetings. The other meetings were arranged between the Islamic Emirate of Afghanistan and the organizations. But in the 3 days we had together, we talked very much in depth about all the humanitarian problems that Geneva Call sees in Afghanistan. And I would say that the conversation was quite open and without any taboos. So I am satisfied also by the conference statement that came out. And I think it was a very good start for an in-depth discussion about the existing problems.
Yes, we have the statement with us here with ourselves. I was going to ask about those statements and I have more questions about that. But want to know that which topics did you discuss with them? What was like the significant topics that was the main agenda for the meeting?
Well, Geneva Call has been engaging the Taliban for several years. So the main topics that we discussed here in Geneva are the topics that we had been discussing in Afghanistan with them for the past years. The first one is the question of landmines. Landmines, as you know, is a big plague for Afghanistan and the necessity to stop laying landmines and to allow the access to all the necessary places of the country for organizations that have the knowledge how to demine. That was the first topic. A second topic that we discussed with them was the problem of the health sector in Afghanistan, particularly the situation of the hospitals in Afghanistan. And as you have seen in the statement that we have signed together, they say that they will be protecting the health sectors and allow all workers, including female workers, to address and to work freely in the health sector.
Have you discussed with him about the human rights here in Afghanistan? Anything else related to the human rights in Afghanistan?
What we have done with them, we have gone through the different international conventions, both the Geneva Conventions and the Conventions on Human Rights, that a country like Afghanistan has signed, and that the government of Afghanistan, even though if it is not yet recognized by the entire community, has to abide with. Yes, we went through these different conventions.
Do you think that the international community and even the international aids as well, organization, convene such meetings with the Taliban, the de facto authorities of the government? Is there a necessity for such meetings?
Well, I think the humanitarian situation in Afghanistan calls for all those who can have an impact on these situations to talk together. What we keep saying as a humanitarian organization, when you have suddenly 23 million Afghans who have done under the poverty line, this should not be politicized. Humanitarian aid should not be politicized. So it is, in our views, essential to talk with all those who can have an impact on this. And the third topic that we discussed a lot during their visit here was exactly that: unimpeded access for humanitarian organizations to the Afghans who are in need right now of humanitarian aid.
You just mentioned that this, all the aids, the humanitarian assistance, should not be politicized. Do you think there is any agency or any country in the world that they want to politicize the humanitarian assistance to the Afghans?
Well, that's I think the whole idea of this meeting here was to try to depoliticize them and to talk with all the actors, as I said, that can have indeed a positive impact on depoliticizing this discussion.
And your statement that you have jointly issued along with the Taliban delegation, that there is something you have discussed about the human rights in Afghanistan, that both sides pledged to serve the human rights in Afghanistan. I want to ask you that, how do you find the human rights in Afghanistan right now under the Taliban government in the country?
Well, I think in the declaration, in the statement, there was not so much about human rights. It was all about humanitarian issues.
But something they have pledged to serve the human rights, the basic needs in the country.
Well, they have pledged to protect the Afghan population. Yes, indeed, they have pledged to do that. And I think this is
protecting what means?
Is providing security for all civilians in Afghanistan.
And what about the poverty in the country?
Poverty has to be addressed on two sides. One side is unimpeded humanitarian access for humanitarian organizations. And the other side, the international community has to look at the situation in Afghanistan, make its own conclusion, and decide whether the international community is happy to have such a humanitarian catastrophe developing in the central part of Central Asia or not.
We have been witnessing numerous meetings, including yours, on Afghanistan after the August, after the political change in the country. Even the international community pledged millions of dollars for the Afghans. But yet we have not seen any significant changes in the lives of the Afghans. Why?
Well, I think because of the international blockade that is there, and this is why for us this meeting was important, because the reason for organizing such a multi-stakeholder event on our side with representatives from different ministries was justified by exactly the fact that you just underlined, in order to provide protection to people in the country and to have all the actors who can help do that have the possibility to meet with the delegation from the Islamic Emirate of Afghanistan their contribution at the end.
Yes, right. But people are losing trust on such meetings anymore, and they're even skeptical of this. Do you think that convening such meetings will change the situation that the Afghans are going through right now?
Well, if we didn't think that, we would not have done it. We think it is essential to talk. The idea of such meetings, when Geneva Call does these kind of meetings with other movements from other parts of the world, we rarely have the media attention that we had in this particular case. But what I can tell you is that it's always better to talk and to try to find solutions than to ignore each other and let then the weapons talk. I think when people can sit down and speak openly about the problems, not about ideology, not about politics, what are the problems? What can you do to help solve them? Are you interested or not in solving them? And what can others do to help solve
Mr.
them?
Mr. That's the basic idea. Yes, right. I'm sorry for interrupting here, but how long should these talks keep going? The people are suffering here. There has to be a final solution, you know, for the crisis that Afghans are faced.
Well,
it's
this
been six
is why
months
we,
that the
we,
government is rolling here, but there is no significant change, even not from their side, neither from the international community side.
Well, this is why we're doing everything we can to correct the situation. I fully hear your anger and I share it. I think things have to change now, not before we have again 10,000 of Afghans suffering and being in a dire strait and a dire situation. So it has to change now. And the willingness to talk was very much there. I mean, including from the big international agencies that have their headquarters in Geneva, most of them answered positively to our proposal to them to come and meet the delegation.
I'm sure that you might have seen people in Afghanistan, majority are begging for a loaf of bread in the country, in every corner of the country, every streets in Kabul especially, if you see. I have asked many people, but I do not find an answer for that. I just want to ask you that whom are you going to hold accountable for the current scenario in the country, the people, desperate people, searching for a loaf of bread in all the corners of the country?
Well, Geneva Call is not trying to make people accountable or to point fingers at people. What we're trying to do as a strictly humanitarian organization is to find solutions.
What's your package of humanitarian aids for the Afghans?
You mean our package, Geneva
yes.
Call's package?
Yes.
Geneva Call's package in all the conflicts where we work is just to ensure that all those who have a responsibility or who are wearing weapons are aware of their obligations under international law. This is our only package, and this is the package that makes us essential in many conflicts. We are not bringing in anything more than this, but this we bring in as efficiently as we can.
There are international assistance that are being sent for the Afghans. Do you think that this sending humanitarian aid for the Afghans is the permanent solution for the crisis that the Afghans are faced?
I think this is certainly a solution for today, but this is not a long-term solution at all. We all know that. I mean, the long-term solution everywhere in a post-conflict or in a conflict that arises is to have an economy that runs and that can bring, self-sustainable incomes for the people of the country. That's certainly what Afghanistan needs in the short term.
The United States has recently unfrozen $3.5 billion of the Afghan assets out of the $7 billion that we have there with them. Do you think that it will help mitigating the economic situation in the country?
Well, I don't know these details. I'm hearing them from you. But what I can say is that clearly Afghanistan needs money now. You see, in many hospitals in Afghanistan, people have not been paid since August. So they're not going to work. And there is a clear need for fresh money just to keep the system going.
Millions of dollars came to Afghanistan, sent by the international community, other sponsor countries in the world. But the question is similar to what I asked just early. But people are still in a desperate situation. Why there is no a committee or an organization that can surveillance or make a transparency of sending the money to the Afghans? Despite the millions of dollars, people are still in the same situation. There is no change in their life.
I think that this is a key issue, a key question that you've just asked here. And all the organizations that remain in the country that they are still working there, this is their key preoccupation to ensure that the aid and the money arrives to the people in need. And the what I hope after the meeting we had last week is that this is clearly ensured and that organizations that left the country in August will be able to come back now with the security that they can work in a way without being impeded and ensuring that, that the services they bring go to the people.
Mr. Director, do you think that it was a fair decision by Biden, the President of the United States, to unfrozen and split the Afghan assets?
As I told you, I haven't looked into the details of this, decision,
but
so I cannot.
You may have some idea
right
about
now.
Releasing the Afghan assets because this. Split it.
What I said before, as a humanitarian organization, we avoid commenting on political issues, but what we keep saying and telling all donors, if there is no money coming into Afghanistan at all, the humanitarian situation will be increasing and Afghanistan will become a nest of poverty and misery in Central Asia. And I think there's no country in the world that has an interest in seeing
great.
That happen.
Right. If you don't have any details about that, but you may have something to share with us, with the people that are watching you right now, was it a fair decision to keep the Afghan assets in the United States or some other countries, despite seeing that what's happening in the ground here in Afghanistan? You may have something
to as I repeat myself, sir, as a humanitarian, we keep telling all donors that there is a need for fresh money and a need for aid in Afghanistan. And so I cannot comment what is fair, not fair, but as a humanitarian, that's what I can tell you.
Because you're involved in humanitarian assistance and all the money released for the humanitarian purpose. Why the meetings that you had with the Afghan delegation being held in closed doors? What was there anything that you didn't want to leak it out? Was there something that you didn't want people know about it?
Well, because in our experience, as Geneva called, when we have discussions like this that are not always easy, when we can keep it discreet, it's not secret, it is discreet. Usually the results are much better. But in that particular case, we did not manage. You know, Geneva is a city with many good journalists like yourself. And basically the second day it was already out in the media. With other movements, as I said at the beginning, that we invite here, we can manage to be discreet. There is much less press attention. But in this case, we could not. After the second day, it was all out in the press. And you've probably seen that journalists have been around, including interviewing the members of the delegation.
Right at the beginning of your conversation, you were talking about the landmines that you have discussed already with the Taliban delegation. Have you ever surveyed Afghanistan, the region, the places, that where is the red line and where we have most of the casualties out of the landmines that are already planted in the country? And what's the plan?
Yeah. Well, the plan is to ensure that the few organizations in the world that have the real professionalism to demine can work unimpededly in Afghanistan. This is, I think, the aim here.
Have you ever surveyed any places, any specific area in Afghanistan or the entire country?
No, we have. I mean, the discussion is about the entire country now and ensuring that these organizations come in and set up their priorities and work.
Mr. Deletro, you were talking about the health crisis as well. You might have seen that what Afghans are going right now here, the health sector is already in the brink of the collapse. What can your organization do for preventing the health sector from collapsing?
I think what we can do is exactly what we've been doing last week. Discussing the issue with the Islamic Emirate of Afghanistan, ensuring that they see that as a priority for themselves, and be ensuring that all the international actors that can do something about it immediately now have the open doors to do it. That's exactly what we tried to do in Geneva last week.
Especially at this critical time where the world is facing a new variant of COVID-19 here in Afghanistan. We do not have any kit in order to diagnose the new variants here. People are suffering a lot. So, as you just mentioned, was there any positive response from the outside world in order to prevent the health sector from collapsing in the country?
You've probably seen that the Director General of the World Health Organization went public and said that he met the delegation. So they had a meeting with the delegation here. I was not in that meeting. As I told you before, we provided the platform, but we decided that they would develop their own agenda. But I'm sure they talked about this during this meeting.
And what do you suggest the World Health Organization in order to do something for the current situation in Afghanistan, especially in the health sector? You may have some suggestions for them.
Well, the suggestion I have is, I think they are pretty obvious. A, help ensure that all the hospitals in Afghanistan can work and no hospital has to close down because of lack of medicine, lack of salaries for their people, and lack of medical material. And B, for the pandemic that the world is crossing, ensuring that
But many of the hospitals are being closed because lack of facilities, lack of staff, lack of no salary, nothing else in the country.
That's exactly the catastrophic situation I was mentioning, and that's exactly what has to be corrected now and not in 2 years, right now.
It's been 6 months since the Taliban are here, and the international community always pledges that they want to do something for the country. But the words just remain as words. We haven't seen anything in practical. Do you think there is just, you know, like trying to turn a blind eye for what's happening in the country from the international community side?
No, I think that nobody can cast a blind eye because the situation is what it is and everybody sees that. But it is time now to make decisions, not only analysis, but decision to move forward.
There is a quote I just want to share it with you. During the situation of armed conflicts, humanitarian norms and principles are respected and millions are protected. It is something that's written on Geneva Calls page. Do you think,
yes.
Do you think this doctrine had been applied in Afghanistan during wartime in the country?
You know, in each war area, getting the different fighting parties to respect international humanitarian law is not easy, but it is essential. It is essential because once the respect
which
for
of
these
the war, mean, which of the warring factions in Afghanistan abided by the rules that is being set from the international community during war?
So you keep willing to have me pointing fingers at people. As I told you, this is not the role
because
of
because you're preventing, you're protecting civilians. There might be some casualties, you know, for civilians in the country, and you may have some people like held accountable for.
Yes, but again, this is not. I fully agree with what you said, but this is not the role of humanitarian workers. The role of this is the role of justice. Or international justice, if local justice cannot do that, but not the role at all of humanitarian workers.
I just want to ask you something about what we have discussed in respect of these things. If you want to suggest something for a permanent solution in the country for the Afghans in order to constrain the situation, what would be that?
Well, what I would hope that happens is that Afghanistan enters a period of peace and that with peace, economic progress will follow, but in the short times, not in 10 years, but in the coming years. This is after all the suffering your country went through all those last 40 years, I would say it is time for Afghanistan to enter a time of prosperity and peace.
And how can we enter to that prosperity? What's the way out for solution?
Well, the way out is having first avoiding now a humanitarian catastrophe and then laying the ground for economic growth in the country.
Mr. Alain Dilits, Director General of Geneva Call, I'm really grateful for your presence here and talking to Thelonious.
Thank you. Thank you so much, and Have a nice day and all my wishes with you for the good job you do.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Goodbye.
بینندگان عزیز، از شما هم جان سپاس.